Hi there, my name is Theodor Mitev, and in this short lecture I will discuss the first stage in developing a digital artifact, that is, the stage of thinking and conceptualizing the parameters of your project. In some respects, this lecture is an elaboration of the project starter tool I use across my classes, which was developed together with my PhD student Travis Wall. You can find a link to the tool in the description of this video. Alright, so before we begin our exploration of the first stage in developing a digital artifact, just a few pointers. Use the following questions that we'll cover to construct a project statement of your own. By all means, use the project statement tool. Try to generate multiple answers to each question. So what this stands for is that you shouldn't be limiting yourself to one specific idea at this stage. You shouldn't be trying to filter out answers that you find too different or too strange or too weird even. Try and produce at least a few variations of your project statement. Once again, do not eliminate any ideas at this stage. We think that multiple ideas are good at this stage because they allow you to explore different variations of your project, and they allow you also to produce statements which you can later test with your potential users. Eliminate ideas only after you test. Finally, pay attention to the rules of thumb at the end of the lecture because they will help you out in terms of taking the next steps. All right, so the first step when it comes to developing your digital artifact and writing up a project statement is to consider the background of your project, the background of your problem. And this is usually a step which students take for granted and therefore step over it and miss it. And as a result, they run into all sorts of problems down the track, such as the most obvious one being, I don't know what to do. I don't know what kind of project to work on. So before you start thinking about your project specifically, think in general about your interests and hobbies. Try and identify them. Write down a list by all means of things that you find interesting, things that you're passionate about, things that you're curious about, or maybe issues or problems that you consider fascinating and worth further exploration. An alternative track is to consider your skills and experiences. Virtually all of you have some sort of skill set already developed. That might be something as simple as recording video or editing images or doing audio stuff. Consider also your experiences in terms of already existing trajectories of making or things that you have a certain inside knowledge of. Consider whether you can use them in your project and to what extent they can be used. Finally, another thing worth to consider is the career path that you want to be on down the track. So think in terms of the next 3 to 5 years, think where you want to be the industry, specifically think of the kind of companies you want to work on. Even better, look at the kind of advertisements these companies are posting, what kind of skill sets do they require. Consider targeting your project to meet those skill sets to allow you to leverage the project in illustrating how you meeting those skill sets, in other words. So be strategic about how you're leveraging the project insofar as you're using it for a career down the track. All right, so the second step after you've considered your background is to try and formulate a problem based on everything that you listed in the background step. So in this step, consider what are the problems you can identify given the knowledge and experiences that you've already listed. What are the issues that emerge from this knowledge and experiences that you can consider as a problem? Consider what are the opportunities you have recognized based on your interests and skills and your strengths. What kind of opportunities have you recognized in terms of your desired career path that you can leverage, right, using this project? The important thing to keep in mind here is that problems and opportunities do not come from isolation. So they do not exist in a vacuum. Often students struggle with this point because they're thinking of the specific problem and the project they want to work on in isolation, as if it existed only within the parameters of the subject they're working, right? So this is totally contrary to the ethos and the philosophy of the digital artifact. So think of problems and opportunities as if they were coming from already existing context. So this can be from your interest, from issues you're dealing with, right? From existing user groups you're a member of, from your past, from existing trajectories. And think in terms of those problems and those opportunities in terms of the direction you want to be in the, let's say, in the next 3 to 5 years. All right, so the next step after that is to consider what you are making based on the background and the problem stages. Put simply, what can you make to address the opportunities and the problems you've identified? So this is a simple description of the digital artifact, and it will really help you when it comes to pitching your project. So you should visualize it as a very simple, very brief project pitch. This is also an important step because if you are following the advice I gave you at the very beginning and you listed a number of ideas, so a number of problems, a number of opportunities, you need to be repeating this step as many times as necessary to meet all these problems and opportunities in terms of making something, right? So be prepared to repeat this step in order to list a number of projects that you can be making. Following the make something stage, we now reach the stage where you describe in detail the entire process involved in performing your artifact. So the important questions to consider here are, what are the mechanics of your digital artifact? So how is it going to work exactly? What are the logistics involved? What would you need in terms of tools? What is involved in the process of making it? Think also in terms of maintaining it, at least throughout the duration of the subject. So this would involve thinking not only as a one-off, but in terms of a cycle of production, curation, feedback and iteration. Think in terms of the platforms that will be involved. Test those platforms if you have no knowledge of them. Often there is a specific learning curve associated with specific platforms, and students ignoring that end up finding themselves wasting an inordinate amount of time to develop that skill set which is relevant to a specific platform. And this overall increases the time cost associated with the project. Which brings me to the next point. Think specifically about the time involved in producing whatever it is that you're going to be making. Be very strategic about time. This relates also to the FIST concepts, the fast, inexpensive, simple, tiny methodology that we already discussed in the previous lecture. Students very often ignore time as part of the cost associated with the production of the artifact, and as a result find themselves failing not because of lack of interest and or ability, but simply because of the absence of time. So be very strategic here. Always go for simplicity, always go for lower cost in terms of time. The final step in formulating a project statement is to consider where do you want to go with this project down the track, right? So how do you want this digital artifact to help you in your future careers or in your plans down the track? So this is the stage where you have to be strategic in your choice of artifacts to work on. Make this project fit your long-term career trajectory and plans. This is advice I always give to students. Many students make the mistake of treating the digital artifact as yet another assessment. They end up obviously producing that assessment, but this qualifies as almost dead labor because it's this artifact, for intents and purposes, is abandoned immediately after the subject. As a result, these students did not leverage all the work they've put in the project towards anything further. Please don't do projects simply as assessments. You're wasting your time. Think in terms of the kinds of trajectory you want to achieve, if your personal trajectory specifically, think in terms of momentum you want to develop, think in terms of long-term strategic career objectives, and plan accordingly when it comes to the projects you want to be working on. All right, so we've gone through all the stages of the project statement, and finally we have a formulated project statement which looks more or less like what we have on the screen here. It sounds more or less like that from my experience in whatever it is you listed as a background, interests, hobbies, passions, knowledge, etc. I know that the problem of, and here you list the specific problem you identified or the opportunities that you listed exists. With these issues in mind, I could make, and here you list exactly what you're making. Remember that whatever it is you're making has to address that problem and that opportunity, right? So it's not, again, appearing in isolation, it's not in a vacuum, it addresses a specific problem, a specific opportunity, and those problems and those opportunities have audiences attached to them, right? And through feedback from these audiences, you will know whether your project has addressed the problem and opportunity. You will do this by describing here how it works. So we are interested in hearing about your methodology, about the logistics and the mechanics of your production process. And this is really important for your own conceptualization of your digital artifact, because it allows you to plan in detail the steps necessary to achieve the overall goal. And finally, this project will help me move towards where do you want to go. Again, here comes the strategic direction, the trajectory you want to achieve. The final thing I wanted to mention here is that you should be doing this project statement, this problem statement for each and every idea, for each and every problem and or opportunity you identified in your list in the very beginning. Iterate, again, repeat, do not eliminate ideas at the beginning. Test them before you eliminate them, right? So it's really helpful to repeat this problem statement a few times, listing a few possible problems and or opportunities. Okay, so what I will do now is go through a few rules of thumb that should help you in conceptualizing your project and in formulating well the overall parameters of the kind of digital artifact you want to be producing. So first of all, you need to remember that you can work on the same digital artifact across different subjects in the digital and social media major. This involves different subjects in the same year, let's say at 100 level, and also different subjects across years, right? So make sure you optimize your work. Do not put yourself in a position where you're working on three or four artifacts in the same session. This doesn't make sense. Try and work towards meta projects which you are in control of, you define, and in which you can fit as if it were modularly digital artifacts that you're working on for specific subjects. Remember also, and I want to emphasize this point yet again, you should plan around projects you can leverage in your future career. Do not work simply for an assessment. Work for a future career, plan accordingly, be strategic in your work. Continuing in terms of rules of thumb, many students end up stressing when they encounter the project statement tool initially and they cannot conceptualize well or verbalize even any one of the stages. So don't panic if you cannot answer all questions immediately. Just iterate, produce spectrum of versions, as I already mentioned, and do not limit ideas initially. Do not check yourself at that stage. It's all right if you cannot immediately figure out how to address a problem, how to close the statement, as it were, or what the mechanics, what the specific steps involved in the production process would entail. We presume that you'll figure this down the track. The important stage here is to try and produce the statement and to test it, right? And when testing, you need to stay open to feedback in iteration, because if you're not, again, you're operating in a vacuum immediately. You're isolating yourself from your users and from potential feedback. Remember to generate more than one answer for each question, if you can, if possible. Do not eliminate ideas at this stage, no matter how weird they might be. Why? Because this allows you to produce a broad spectrum of options. Often this produces ideas that you wouldn't have normally considered, but once framed in a coherent project statement, they end up being doable. Remember to document all your ideas. And this includes documenting not only the initial idea, but also all the follow-up stages, and documenting the testing process, documenting feedback. Remember to screenshot everything, right? So this should be almost like a mantra for all of you: screenshot everything at all times. In more general terms, please remember that making involves risk. Making is a risky activity. Why? Because you are contacting reality, as it were. Reality speaks back, and reality always brings corrections to our assumptions. So when you make something, when you're making media content, for example, or you're working on some more complex digital media project, inevitably this entails all sorts of risk in terms of your engagement with platforms, with tools, with users, or with time even. So take this into consideration. Be aware also that we are aware, in terms of the people who are marking you, that making involves risk, and don't stress too much if you've run into insurmountable obstacles. Which brings me to the following point. You need to remember that making always involves resistance, encountering resistance. That resistance comes from your medium, first and foremost, whatever the medium you're working in. So whether that's audio, video, still images, or a mixture of all of those, whether that's text, etc., etc., etc. Your tools also continuously resist your efforts to produce whatever it is you're making. Your users are also offering resistance continuously, right? So what's important here is not to treat those resistances as obstacles. What's important is to treat them as so many feedback sources, right? So treat all resistance as feedback, iterate based on that feedback, and test again and again and again. Remember also to base your project on the fail early, fail often philosophy, and on the fast, inexpensive, simple, tiny methodology. We've discussed them in previous lectures. This is important because the FIFO philosophy and the FIST methodology allow you to iterate fast, to prototype very fast your ideas, and to have tight feedback loops with your users. Now, which brings me to the following very important point. This is a point that students often stress about. If you change your mind midway through, let's say, or your project for whatever reason falls apart, reaches a dead end, whatever, don't panic. Don't allow this to derail you. Don't allow this situation to stress you in any way. What we're interested in is the documentation of that obstacle, or that whatever that reason was that brought you to a full stop. So document everything up to that point and immediately start a new project, right? So pivot away from the project you are working on, salvage whatever you can by all means, and start a new project straight away. Instead, in your process, we want to see the logistics of how you operated in terms of iterations, feedback, testing, prototyping. We are not interested in some arbitrary endpoint which would produce some arbitrary creative whatever, right? We are specifically interested in process. So do not despair if you are running into an insurmountable obstacle. Pivot away, start a new project, keep documenting your process. Remember that your process consists of production, aggregation, and curation, right? So you are developing content, aggregating it, curating it for an audience. You are encountering users. You are integrating user feedback in your project, and you are iterating again, going again through the entire cycle. So focus on those elements in your process. Focus on those elements in terms of your documentation. Finally, and I need to emphasize that because quite a few students forget completely about this important element, and this is the most important element of the entire digital artifact experience. If you're not enjoying your digital artifact, you're doing it wrong. This is your project. You developed the parameters, you brought in the motivation, you took the responsibility, you should be enjoying it, right? If you're not, there was something wrong along the way. Have fun, enjoy your work, and good luck. Thank you for listening, guys. If you have any questions, hit me up on Twitter at TedMeetYou, and see you online.